Greetings. In the past, I've adopted a phrase, this whole prophecy thing, ain't no stopping it. Well, I've been thinking about it, and I think certain aspects of prophecy are inevitable. One might call it the sound of inevitability.
That is the sound of inevitability.
Point one, the one world government. Take a step back and cogitate on the human being. If you believe the Judeo-Christian worldview, there are several fundamental principles our view elucidates. Principle 1. Mankind is created in God's image. Mankind was created as close to God as a created being can be created. Psalm 8:4. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the Elohim, translated angels, but Elohim is the Hebrew word, and has crowned him with glory and honor. Elohim is the same Hebrew word used in Genesis 1. Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. For thou hast made him a little lower than the Elohim. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. From this, I gather that man's position in God's creation is higher than most of us allow ourselves to imagine. Male and female created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam in the day when they were created. So principle one, man is created in God's image. Thou made him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet. All sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, the fowl of the air and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passes through the paths of the sea. Is there any life on earth that does not appear dominated by human beings? I imagine some might argue bacteria and viruses are not dominated by mankind. Principle 2. In God's scenario, the individual is who is important. By that, I specifically contrast the group, the collective, the state which humans coalesce to. God's plan is the salvation of individuals, each given free will. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The phrase whosoever speaks of individuals and their personal, individual belief. Salvation is offered to single individuals based on their individual decisions. The lone exception that screams in my awareness is Israel, the offspring of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Romans 11:25, I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers, so that you will not be conceited. A hardening in part has come to Israel until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved. As it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will remove godlessness from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. The nation of Israel is spoken of as a group with which God has a direct relationship. But don't get fixated on that to the point of confusion. Your relationship with Jehovah God is by grace, a free gift, because you were once a foreigner to God's covenant with Abraham. John 10:16, I have other sheep which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will hear my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd. Ephesians 2:13, But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. John 10:27, My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. And here we go in a direction I did not see coming. Matthew 7:22, Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. And then will I profess to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. Jesus knows his sheep, and his sheep follow his voice. Learn to listen to his voice if you are one of his sheep. I freely admit that is very easy to say and very hard to learn to do. I submit the first step on this journey is to not assume you know God's voice. Romans 8:12, Therefore, brothers, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery that returns you to fear, but you received the spirit of sonship by whom we cry, Abba, Father. Oh, I'd love to go into that and how that deals with Islam. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. And if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Going back just a moment, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. My sheep listen to my voice, I know them, and they follow me. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. To be led implies you must follow. Not just listen politely and then go your own way according to your own plan. Getting back to my own way, what I thought God wanted me to talk about. Principle 2. In God's scenario, the individual is who important. If the individual and individual rights are God's plan, whose plan might be described as the state's control and ownership of the individual? Take a moment and think about who might just oppose the plan of God. Here's a hint. Matthew 16:23. But Jesus turned and said to Peter, Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. Now, if you said, Peter, we're going to need some time after class. The password is Satan, whose plan might be an evil, totalitarian, anti-Christian, globalist, one-world government. A plan to elevate the state, the group, the collective, over individuals and individual rights. Satan. Now, I prepared this script for this video about a week ago. Sometimes I feel I need to stew and percolate and cogitate and meditate because the concept seems so far afield. Then today I found the time to listen fully to a video from PragerU. Dennis was interviewing someone I respect and pray will find the truth of the Lord Jesus, Dr. Jordan Peterson. The video is titled Interview, Jordan Peterson and Dennis Prager at the 2019 PragerU Summit. The following is a fair use extract for educational purposes.
So,
if I'm going to ask you, it may strike you as absurd, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Except for technical knowledge like medicine or engineering, mathematics, obviously any of the natural sciences, law, if all North Americans graduating high school decided, I'm not going to college, would North America be a better or a worse place?
If you took away the STEM fields.
Yeah, taking away the STEM fields.
I think that universities, not colleges necessarily, I think that universities do more harm than good now. And I'm very loath to say that, you know, because I've been part of the academy for 30 years and taught at great institutions. But the postmodern collectivist doctrine is so psychologically and politically toxic that I think that academia now does more harm than good. And it's not only what it teaches, which is the ideology, this ungrateful ideology, which denies the existence of the individual. One of the things I might tell you, just so you know this, is that, you know, that you hear that there are debates about free speech on campus, about who should talk and who shouldn't, and people think that's what the debate is about who should talk and who shouldn't. But that's not what the debate is about. That you're not even scraping the surface of the debate if that's what you think it's about. The debate on campus is about whether or not a human being has the capacity to communicate intelligibly as an individual or not. And the answer for the postmodernist collective types is that there is no such thing as an individual. And therefore, the very notion of free speech is absurd, because free speech is predicated on the idea that each of us have something to say that's ours. It's a consequence of our unique individuality, not our group identity or the multiplicity of our group identities, but something that we have that speaks from our spirit, that can speak to the spirit of another and produce a negotiated peace. And that's what's being debated. The war that's going on philosophically or theologically in the campuses is far deeper than you think. The entire notion of the reality of the individual, which is, I think, also the entire notion of the idea that human beings are made in the image of God, most fundamentally, that is what's being attacked. It wasn't for nothing that Derrida called Western culture phallogocentric. Phallus for masculine, logos for logos, for truth and courage, and centric for centric. That was a criticism from his perspective. The idea of the sovereignty of the individual. If you don't have the idea of the sovereignty of the individual, because there's no individual, there's no free speech. All you are is an avatar of your group interests. And if I'm not in your group, it's not in my interest to let you speak. There's nothing that we have to say to one another. There's nothing but power. It's a Hobbesian nightmare of group against group. And that's the postmodern doctrine. And so it's to call it appalling is to barely scrape the surface. It's an assault. It is truly an assault on the most fundamental principles by which the West is governed. It's not surface level philosophy. It goes all the way to the bottom.
I found his statements a direct confirmation of what I have been percolating on for a month now. Boil down the human struggle, and it is the individual, created by God in the image of God, against Satan's scheme to pit group against group. The strategy is well known. It is called divide and conquer. The leftists are anti-individual. They are of the Antichrist. Feminists are evil. They are Antichrist. They divide women against men. Black Lives Matter is evil. It is anti-Christ. It divides blacks against all other races. Atheism is evil, and it is anti-Christ. It aspires to divide the brights and the intelligent against those they consider stupid. Islam is evil, and it is anti-Christ. Islam divides the world and renders Muslims as valueless slaves. Weapons with lungs and legs and nothing more. As you pursue truth, review the concept you are meditating on. Does it value the individual, or does it crush the individual and subjugate the individual to the group identity? But do not think for a second God has not seen Satan's schemes in advance. But that is not the point I started out to make. My point is about the inevitable coming of the one world government, and the absolute certainty it is evil. Do not be confused with God's theocracy that Yeshua will establish on earth. The kingdom of Yeshua, the Son of Man, will in no ways be evil. When God's righteousness rules, the corruption of human power structures and deceptions will be weeded out by the Holy Spirit. Acts 5:1. Now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back some of the proceeds for himself, but brought a portion and laid it at the apostles' feet. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and withhold some of the proceeds from the land? Did it not belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? How could you conceive such a deed in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. On hearing these words, Ananias fell down and died. And great fear came over all who heard what had happened. Then the young men stepped forward, wrapped up his body, and carried him out and buried him. About 3 hours later, his wife also came in, unaware of what had happened. Tell me, said Peter, is this the price you and your husband got for the land? Yes, she answered, that is the price. How could you agree to test the Spirit of the Lord? Peter replied. Look, the feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also. In that instant, she fell down at his feet and died. Then the young men came in and found her dead. So they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear came over the whole church and all who heard about these events. There will be no definition of is discussed in the kingdom of the Son of Man. There will be no treasonous conspiracy to steal elections by illegal voters. There will be no fraudulent dossiers created and foisted as true upon the ruling courts. Justice will not only be swift, it will be accurate and perfect and righteous. The point I am fundamentally trying to communicate is this. As you seek the truth and seek to avoid the damning strong delusion, a filter you can apply is whether the idea, concept, program, or approach the world is pushing liberates the individual or subjugates the individual to the state. The state is Satan's false kingdom, and he will attempt to abolish Christianity and kill any Christians who will not submit. Clearly, beheadings will happen, but not all killings will be so brutal or so rapid. Look to Venezuela and the starvation created by the socialist state there. Coming soon to a socialist enclave and totalitarian SJW safe space near you. Luke 21:36. Be always on the watch and pray that you may be able to escape all that is about to happen, and that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.